I am indeed very happy that by inviting me here, the NYU has given me the opportunity to make a humble contribution to this larger scheme of things. Now, I propose to start this lecture on the relevance and irrelevance of Muslim political traditions today with a reference to matters that some of you may find unusual in the circumstances or even irrelevant to the matter at hand, Islam being the matter of concern of this lecture. I shall start with St. Paul the Apostle. In his epistle to the Romans, he is purported to have stated, and I quote, "There is no authority except from God." Turning again to the Gospels, we learn from the Acts of the Apostles that, and I quote again, "We must obey God rather than man." In addition to this apparent advocacy of a theocratic order, we also find in the Gospels a rather more complex, a more decidedly political statement of the workings of theocracy, mediated here by the sacral, or at least the sanctified, character of authority over all. We read again, allegedly from the pen of St. Paul, and I quote, "Let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God." And to end this rather random selection of fragments or proof texts from the Holy Writ, I might mention the famous statement of the Gospel of Matthew about rendering unto Caesar what is Caesar's and unto God what is God's. This is, as is well known, a statement regarding the payment of taxes to the Roman state. It is often thoughtlessly generalized and invoked with the intention of demonstrating, rhetorically in my view, that Christianity is scripturally predisposed to the separation of church and state. Such an interpretation of the scripture is not, of course, shared by all. One need only look at Byzantium to realize it cannot sustain this interpretation. A consideration of the late medieval and early modern papacy will yield the same realization. And more recently, Pope Pius IX, in his famous Syllabus of Errors of 1864, in which he anathemized secularism, separation of state and church, and so forth, he was determinedly opposed to any separation of church and state. Yet Matthew's statement is the locus classicus for allegedly demonstrating a supposedly irreducible and generic difference between Islam and Christianity in regard to their respective conceptions of the relation between religion and state in general. I did not start this lecture with quotations from the New Testament in order to offer you a comparison between Christian and Muslim scriptures or to propose a typology of Christian and Muslim political traditions, suggestive as such comparisons might be. My purpose, rather, is to invite reflection, and above all, to invite discrimination. Reflection upon the relevance of the scriptural quotations for any study of history of the highly divergent political forms in evidence in the very long history of polities arguably Christian or post-Christian. It would be foolhardy indeed, and would invite ridicule for any scholar to claim that she might be able to trace to such scriptural fragments the empires of Constantine the Great, Theodosius, the succession of Holy Roman Emperors, the Plantagenets and Ottonians, the reign of Henry VIII, the Normans of Sicily, the polities of Calvin in Geneva, Bussin in Strasbourg, Anabaptists in Münster, Puritans of New England, no less than the House of Windsor, still reigning by grace of God in Britain today, a very highly secularized society, unlike the United States. Nor can the Gospels be considered as a key to studying the Christian Democratic Party headed by Chancellor Merkel in Germany, a country, it must be said, somewhat less godless than Britain. I can discern no general disposition, at least among the lettered public, to embrace the absurd view that all these polities might be virtually indistinguishable, being Christian. It is unthinkable that they might be generically one for being Christian, or indeed, that they might constitute a Christian political tradition which is alive today. This is because such a procedure would defy the standard canons of historical research and of the historical understanding, for there is generally, in the historical profession, an appreciation of complexity and of mutability, of the vast complexity in the relations that exist between scriptural proof texts and the uses to which they are often put. It is anyway not the case, except among marginal sectarian formations, like the Amish of Pennsylvania or radical jihadists, to consider that political and social arrangements are or can be generated from scriptures. Rather, it is the case that scriptural quotations and references are brought to bear as interpretations of doctrinal formulations and social and political arrangements that have their causes elsewhere, in culture, in society, in polity. Dogma and practice can by no means be regarded as equivalent. Tensions and ambivalences are characteristic of them. One might refer here to the Catholic aggiornamento of the 1960s, following what is known as Vatican II. This implied no dogmatic or theological adjustment, as distinct from social and political shifts of position arising from what was primarily a political imperative. Let us recall, crucially, that the historical profession and some of its major canons start from the fact that histories, societies, and polities are not reducible to cultures, that cultures are not reducible to dogmas, and that dogmas are not reducible to scriptures in any simple way, but that these instances of theology, dogma, society, culture, and polity are differentiated and enter into very complex relations. Finally, there is generally an appreciation of the vast historical mutation resulting from modernity. Now, by the same token, I see no intellectual as distinct from political or ideological grounds to suspect such historical judgment when it comes to matters, to suspend such historical judgments when it comes to matters Islamic, and to declare boldly that the Baghdad caliphs, the Mamluks, the Ottomans, no less than post-Ottoman states of modern Turkey, Syria, or Tunisia, are all essentially related by Islamic political traditions. And that, moreover, such traditions may still be active and determinant, that they are shared by the Muslim Brothers, the Taliban, Turks in Germany, Mirpuri Kashmiris in Bradford. Such assumptions are implicit in much public discourse today. Yet one does discern, and discern acutely, that there is generally, in Europe as among Muslims generally speaking, a decided incuriosity. There is a lack of analytical interest, and an assumption that matters arising from what might conveniently but inaccurately be termed Islamic history can be handled in terms of simplistic assumptions and categories that are inherently resistant to the sort of critical examination that is generally assumed in treating other histories. Thus, on an assumption of the great Muslim exception to history, it is often proposed to me that I address the questions of whether religious freedom, religious tolerance, and the separation of state and religion might be legitimated by Islam. A question framed in such a way is based on a number of presumptions, and it is often so framed in public discourse in a variety of tonalities, and not only in Europe and the United States. The presumption is that polities in Muslim countries, or rather in countries of Muslim majorities, as I prefer to call them, are still, at the beginning of the 21st century, emerging from what are vaguely described as Muslim traditions, and that they require deliberate religious legitimation. These Muslim traditions may be described in a variety of ways, but they are nevertheless thought to constitute, on the presumption I'm discussing now, as initial conditions from which one might or might not be able to look forward towards religious freedom, religious tolerance, and the separation of state and religion. In other words, what we have here is the model of a truly extraordinary and exceptional collectivity called Muslims, frozen, rendered wooden, in a perpetual moment of inception called tradition. These Muslims, or rather super-Muslims, perpetuate this moment, this initial condition in present circumstances, when they find themselves confined to an identity trap which culturalizes and sublimates political and social issues, and economic issues as well, and renders them matters for religious tradition, unlike other species of humanity. Let us, for the moment, bracket aside the fact that the past two centuries brought about profound transformations in Muslim lands and among Muslims generally. These ran largely parallel to transformations in European cultures, societies, and polities, however asymmetrically, and however unevenly inside Muslim lands. And one needs to recall the unevenness of transformations in Europe as well, and in the United States. They are evident to all who wish to run a reality test. Forms of discourse, political ideologies, habits of dress, relative emancipation of women, bureaucratic states, modern universities and school systems, the salience of scientific knowledge for understanding not only nature, but society and polity as well. All of these are very real. They are of European provenance, but have in the meantime become indigenized and locally reproduced. Further, if we were hypothetically to accept that the initial condition called Muslim traditions still prevails as social practice rather than as an ideological motif, we shall need to look at precisely what it is that might characterize and describe it. Looking at such questions as those I just mentioned, I do not think I would be terribly mistaken if I read it as referring to tradition in the guise of dogma. A reference to dogma, and most specifically, scripturalist dogma, simplistically conceived as a grid onto which political arrangements are to be mapped. Of course, such an interpretation of the questions often put to me is premised on an altogether common but untested assumption that Muslim histories, societies, cultures, and polities, for all their vast complexity, have been generated and are still driven by the Quranic text, or with an impression of complexity only apparently greater, that Muslims are congenitally nomocratic. There is the implicit assumption that Muslim histories are congenitally bookish and legalistic, that ultimately the Muslim nomos derives from the Muslim logos, that Muslim social and political arrangements always remained the same, and that this initial condition and this generic exceptionalism still obtains today. Now, I should like to contest these assumptions and to propose to you that such conceptions of Muslim polity are not the evident reflections of some historical reality, but are specific to the time when they emerged. The logocentric cliché was not thinkable in terms of Muslim traditions before the 20th century, but is rather made possible by the impact of Protestantism on the historical profession, including Oriental studies, and on Muslim reformism. The appeal to what the Protestants call sola sancta scriptura, that is to say, the holy text only, made by the Protestant Reformation with tremendous complexity of meaning and effect, I might add, has no equivalent in classical Islam. It had no equivalent in Catholicism or in Orthodoxy either, and still doesn't. In all the religious traditions mentioned, scripture, dogma, theology, legal, and other orders were layered. The relations between the layers was complex and changed over time, for all the rhetorical and pietistic primacy given to scripture throughout. There are in Catholicism and in Orthodoxy as well, biblical and apostolic traditions. There are also patristic traditions, imperial traditions, theological traditions, traditions of canon law and of exegesis, glosses, commentaries, and ecclesiastical and papal traditions. There are in Islam the traditions of the Quranic scripture and its multifarious interpretations, but also the vastly complex and contradictory corpus of prophetic traditions, which have canonical status. There are juristic traditions, socio-political, and hierocratic traditions known as consensus or ijma'. Consensus itself is layered in its turn, distinguishing those traditions supposedly the subject of consensus by the Prophet's immediate associates from those of various later generations, roughly corresponding to the patristic traditions of Christianity. There are also various theological and doctrinal traditions, much at variance with each other, often violently and bloodily so. To all these should be added crucially imperial, caliphal, and sultanic traditions. All these traditions bear upon society and polity, but also define the terms of reference of dogma, which is not definable with reference to scripture alone. Now, the emphasis on scripturalism has been enormously influential in scholarship and in public perception, but it represents a specifically Protestant inflection in the history of religions. Like their Protestant exemplars, Muslim reformists in the 19th and 20th centuries resorted to the slogan ad fontes, to the origins. In Arabic, appeal to as-salaf, as-salaf as-salih, by token of their disaffection with tradition, especially clerical traditions as they existed. Modern Muslim fundamentalists have used the slogan in much narrower and often apparently very literalist senses and for more restrictive purposes. Finally, and very importantly in my view, although the Quran contains passages that might be construed as egalitarian and others as authoritarian, there is no evidence whatsoever that the Quran was subject of a specifically political reading before the 20th century. With respect to legalism, let us not forget that the fuqaha were lawyers and judges. They were above all practical men, and that they were ideologues only in the second instance and in ways that had little consequence for the legal process itself. This is not to suggest a disjunction between ideal and reality, but arises from a reflection upon the interplay between law and social practice at all times and places. And from the universal fact that a legal system is an instance, not of the first, but of final appeal, in situations where conflicts cannot be resolved by the usual social practices of mediation, negotiation, and appeal to current norms and customs. In any event, the legal systems of traditional Muslim societies were complex and involved courts that used classical Muslim law, but also others, just as important, which were under state jurisdiction, called al-mazalim, and used procedural and substantive means and concepts distinct from those of Muslim law. But all of this seems of little relevance today. With relevance to modern times, only very few Muslim countries do not have a code of civil law modeled upon Napoleonic lines. And when and if some countries, such as Iran, Sudan, or Pakistan, introduce Islamic law, they invariably do so with a considerable amount of violence, a fact which is eloquent testimony to the claim that classical Muslim law is out of keeping with contemporary social norms, legal systems, practices, and notions. Moreover, the character of Muslim legislation politically imposed in this way is appreciably different from the classical models and constitutes a break with legal practices that one would ascribe to tradition and to forms of legal order in place for over a century, causing much disorientation and disruption. The slogan of the implementation of Sharia is the result of political and ideological will, and is at variance with actual social practice rather than signaling historical continuity. It is perhaps best characterized as a form of political theater, featuring spectacles of extraordinary punishments and visible, invisible women. So the short answer to the kinds of questions put to me as to whether Muslim traditions might sustain religious freedom, tolerance, democracy, and so forth is a yes and a no. Both must be qualified by history. The answer is yes, it is the case that Muslim reformism, on the ascendant for nearly a century until the 1970s, did accommodate very modern notions and indeed found them crucial to the public interest and to the common weal. Reformists adopted a variety of apologetic and rhetorical means of accommodating modernity to the scriptures, and indeed to finding them inherent in these scriptures. It still does so. And the answer is also no, because there has grown, for a number of reasons, only some of which have anything to do with religion, a powerful current of social conservatism and of by now internationalist political Islamism. in the name of particularism or even of primitivism, this broad trend adopted, like the Protestants, the ad fontes Salafism approach to religion in a restrictive manner. This is as rudimentary intellectually as it is incendiary politically and socially. In many ways, it has strong affinities with politically activist American evangelism. Much like the latter, it seeks to roll back developments and advances of the 19th and 20th centuries. The fundamentalist element has in the past two decades incontestably grown and generally so increased its social salience that it has overall pushed the reformist current from the center of religious life it occupied for over a century to the margins, placed it under siege, and caused it defensively to harden its positions. It is growing, its growing political importance and its apparently photogenic and spectacular character has habituated people to refer indiscriminately to religion, society, and polity, and to regard them as images of each other, deriving uniformly from tradition, and most specifically from scripturalist tradition. This is, of course, easy, but it is quite wrong. In light of all this, I should like to propose to you the following as the main point I wish to convey to you. Islamic political traditions, whatever they might be, and however they may be defined, are an unnecessary interpretative assumption. The assumption that they might help interpret historical itineraries and present conditions, and that they might additionally contribute to framing present and future social and political arrangements, is one that violates the conceptual economy of scientific research and poses false problems. I have indicated already that the Quran cannot be regarded as a repository of political traditions that one might characterize as Muslim. There is no precedent in Muslim traditions for a Quranic exegesis designed to elaborate a political theory before the attempt of Sayyid Qutb in the middle of the 20th century. Such would have been unthinkable to medieval Muslim divines, whose conception of text was, as I've suggested, thoroughly intertextual, and to whom the slogan of going back entirely to the scripture was hardly conceivable in any consequential way, notwithstanding the Pope's statements in Regensburg not long ago. And there are no Quranic statements as theocratic in import as the New Testament proof texts I quoted at the beginning of this lecture. And I need say little about what occurs in the Old Testament. The question that needs to be posed is therefore this: what might Islamic political traditions actually have been? Now, to consider this, I shall need to turn to history, not to some timeless and supposedly ever-persisting initial condition lodged in Muslim doctrines and in the Muslim canon, and indeed hardwired into the minds and sensibilities of all Muslims. Turning to history and to historical anthropology would reveal a number of interesting features of all traditions. It would reveal that rather than conservation being a property of events in the present, traditionalist discourses put forward the notion of continuity with and conservation of past events as hypotheses in order to account for whatever repetition of the ritual order that is being performed. What this implies is a matter contrary to the widely held strong anthropological hypotheses that utterances and actions repeated that constitute traditions are held together by some underlying intellectual project, such as a worldview, a cultural pattern, collective representations, or some form of local knowledge, including traditionalist Muslim knowledge. What I am claiming runs contrary to the unquestioned intellectualist assumptions that cultural models cause actual behavior. A person taking communion, for instance, in a church, is primarily engaged in a sacrificial rite, whose explanation is anthropological. Not theological. he or she does so irrespective of the theology of transubstantiation by Catholics or consubstantiation by the Orthodox and the Protestants. Disputes about the interpretation of this particular ritual during the Reformation, for instance, are of an order different to that of the sacrifice itself, which is practiced by both the Protestant and Catholic parties to the dispute. Similarly, a practicing Muslim observes a certain number of daily prayers as acts of devotion, which again find their explanation in the anthropology of religion. That classical Muslim jurisprudence, with a very keen anthropological eye, realized that this specific number, 5 a day, was arbitrary, exercised for the sake of the ritual act itself and for its social consequences, is immaterial to the observance itself. Ritual occurs at a zero degree of signification. Explanation and theorization occur at a different order and speak of the insertion of ritual in a variety of very different social and intellectual settings. Beyond ritual, therefore, beyond culturalist intellectualism, there are a number of cultural, intellectual, political, and institutional settings that come into the description of Muslim political traditions. I hope that I have made a sufficiently cogent case for the view that traditions, however identified and understood, find their explanation in social history, in historical anthropology, in the structure and history of discursive formations, and that they are unnecessary and indeed wayward hypotheses when put forward as historical explanations. Having done this, I can now move on and ask, what were Muslim political traditions? What is it that might permit us to denominate certain traditions as Muslim? And what is it that might remain beyond the name for all the sentimental resonance of a name? I'm afraid there can be no summary answer to this question that would settle the matter once and for all. The crucial point to be made is that there is a history of such traditions, however they might be defined. And there are many such traditions with many histories, to the understanding of which time and place are crucial. Now, the initial time and place that saw the emergence of Muslim political traditions were quite simply those of late antiquity. More specifically, the 7th and 8th centuries in Western Asia and the Mediterranean basin. For centuries, these had been territories of vast imperial regimes: Hellenistic, Roman, late Roman, Byzantine East Roman, Sasanian Persian. These were regimes with well-articulated polities, with political theologies, Palatine institutes, and socio-political arrangements and practices, of which the Arab empires of the Umayyads and the Abbasids were heirs, most often very consciously, very self-consciously, and without apology. It would not be reasonable to suppose, as it is often supposed, that the Arabs exploded out of the Arabian Peninsula upon a political tabula rasa and built something without precedent, hands aloft, with book in one hand, sword in another, and precious little in between. Much like the Goths who insinuated themselves into the traditions of Rome, like the Bulgars and later the Serbs who built up their polities under the canopy of Constantinople, so also did the Arab Muslims. Initially, a ruling caste who commanded countries like Syria and Egypt, which were to remain predominantly Christian, incidentally, more or less until the time of the Crusades. A ruling military caste which fell upon well-developed imperial traditions and territories and constituted imperial polities, not very dissimilar to those already in place, albeit using a different linguistic medium for culture, a new ecumenical language of Arabic and a new religion. As some recent scholarship suggests, the Arab empires of the Umayyads and the earlier Abbasids was in many respects the fulfillment of Constantine's dream, combining over a vast Eurasian expanse imperial ecumenism a salvation historical conception of polity, and a political theology of the imperial office, now represented by the caliph. Having mentioned Constantine, one would need to speak to say a few words about Constantine's political theologian, Eusebius of Caesarea in Palestine, who developed a florid notion of the imperial person in the language of Neoplatonism, a notion that related the emperor directly to God, and indeed used the same term, basileus, for both God, God the Son, and the emperor. This self-same rhetorical building of analogies between the one and the other, and of grafting the example of the one upon the other in a variety of very interesting ways, theologically very risky, was employed in the medium of Arabic and with references to Muslim notions by courtiers of the caliphs, poets, state secretaries, and literati, ulama, and later philosophers. It was this group of people around the court who gave rise to Islamic political thought and traditions. And the Muslim ulama most certainly were not far from this enterprise themselves. All wrote books of advice for kings and histories, composed poems and other literary works, authored and translated treatises on ethics and government, which gathered in the vast corpus of materials bequeathed by earlier imperial regimes and proclaimed the lofty transcendence of the imperial office now occupied by the caliph, after the examples of Alexander, Ardashir, and a variety of other historical exemplars. We have here a conception of state as generator of public order, including legal order, and a notion of the imperial office as the guarantor of order, according to a very pessimistic anthropology, perhaps best expressed in a statement attributed to Ibn al-Muqaffa, in which he said that evil inheres in man, and that the evil of men always lights up exactly as two flint stones would light up when rubbed together. This was well represented by Palatine institutes, which were imitated in the provincial capitals outside Damascus and Baghdad. Conventions of speech and physical distance, courtly ceremonial, codes of dress, conventions of authority, hierarchy, secrecy, wile, statecraft, and administration. These were highly elaborated in practice as courtly rituals and as expressions of the imperial office and of its patrimonial mode of operation. In this respect, the caliphate utilized conceptions and institutes in place, ancient imperial codes of conduct and of statecraft that had also seen the day among the Byzantines and the Persians. It is true that the early Umayyads and the earliest Abbasids tried ostentatiously to put themselves forward also as inheritors of specifically Arab traditions. But this amounts to antiquarian folklorization, merely underlining their distance from their Arabian origins. What we had by way of political traditions under the caliphate is therefore a typically late antique arrangement, which had no loyalty to ethnic origin or to religious affiliation. And indeed, the ultimate development and the last form of such late antique imperialism, despite the Muslim signature. This naturally invites the question of what it is that might allow us to characterize the caliphate as Islamic. The caliphs were God's own deputies, Khulafa Allah. Like the King of Kings and the Byzantine Basileus, emperor. But they were also the prophet's deputies and legatees. They were Muhammad's in two senses. First, that they were the continuators of his specific prophetic dispensation, the last of all dispensations, and the carriers in human time of his prophetic charisma, which carried the name of Islam. And second, that the caliphal dynasties were related to Muhammad ibn Abdullah by blood, the blood of a special Qurayshite stock elected by God and by dynasticism, expressed with this genealogical inflection is also arguably Muslim, but neither generically nor exclusively so. But it must not be supposed that over and above the name, there might have been a continuity with the Muhammadan prototype. The early Arab Muslim polity in Medina, though regarded as exemplary and highly mystified, was very early on characterized as a miraculous period in human history. Unlike modern and contemporary fundamentalists, Muslims in the classical age did not regard this golden age to be in any practicable way repeatable. Nor did they see it as an utopia in the past which might be reinstated. It occurred once, miraculously, and will occur again at the end of time. In between, empires must be ruled as empires always were, with the firm hand of a patrimonial universalism correcting the incorrigibly crooked timber of humanity. Nevertheless, like its Byzantine counterpart, the Caliphate also had a religious mission, very explicitly. The Caliphate was a regime for ruling this world and preparing humanity for the end, according to a theology of salvation history with a decided salience to Byzantium and a definite expression in Muslim scriptures. To this extent, it might be characterized as Islamic, but not in the sense that it is exclusive to Islam. Most specifically, this preparation of humanity took the form of the caliphal state presiding over a legal order, in principle, but not always in practice, and not least owing to the limits of control of communication characteristic of the age. This was a body of law, classical Muslim law, very complex in form and perhaps somewhat more elaborate than Roman law, and certainly more comprehensive, that was decidedly connected to religion in its theoretical conception, although in practice it derived from considerations that were all too human. It is a body of law that in the 11th century came to comprehend the caliphate and the state in general as one of its topics. Apart from devotional matters, Islamic law is law as normally understood, with a Muslim signature, the law of a particular time and place. In this regard, one might take the caliphate as a particular inflection of late antique empire in general, and the Muslim legal theory of the state as a technical Muslim legal specification and interpretation of public law overall. When in the 13th century the caliphate came to an end with the Mongol destruction of Baghdad and the sultanate, which existed beforehand under caliphal ages, became the order of the day, the same public responsibilities of government under the caliphate were devolved to sultanic institutions, as they had been in a variety of regions, to sultanates that coexisted with the caliphate. Thereafter, the Ottomans, Safavids, the Mughals of India, and many other regimes, some imperial in outlook, but according to a new notion, charted a number of other tracks and accumulated a variety of political traditions, some very novel, some less so. It is not for nothing that the earlier Ottoman sultans had themselves referred to as Caesars of the Romans, and that they, like their Byzantine predecessors, had the authority to designate the Orthodox Patriarch of Constantinople and to invest him with his pectoral cross. Yet it is the Muslim expression of political authority and of public authority overall, expressed in legal, pietistic, and homiletic works, with their constant and sometimes exclusive reference to scripture, that is generally taken today for Muslim political traditions overall. Such specifically religious expressions of political authority were, in historical fact, only one Muslim political tradition among many, and generally a marginal one. This is an exorbitantly abbreviated version of history, which itself has a history. This is a history that I might address very briefly as I wind down my lecture to a close. This is, above all, a history that has to do with modernity. Two matters stand out. The first is that since the middle of the 19th century, and with few regional exceptions, older political traditions entertained by Muslims, including the Ottomans, had experienced a decisive break as Muslim states modernized wholesale and spoke the language of representation, of the nation, of bureaucracy, civil law codes, democracy, of socialism, of secularism. They thereby, and in effect, rendered all but forgotten the older modes of organizing political life. Women in Syria obtained the right to vote somewhat earlier than their French counterparts. Representative government came to the fore among the Ottomans, no matter how briefly, at more or less the same time as it did in Prussia. Secular education was introduced in Istanbul before it became common in England. Darwinism was positively debated in Beirut when it was treated with great reticence in the United States. Altogether, Muslim lands in varying degrees went through an accelerated and generally state-directed social, cultural, and political change, which made them in many crucial respects unrecognizable if compared to previous times. So any appeal to what I called earlier initial conditions would seem to be of little relevance, not least because the Muslim ulama had been very much diminished and socially and politically marginalized in the past 150 years. Yet there is also, and in increasing force in the past two decades, much talk about a golden age, the Muhammadan era in Medina, of medieval Islamic law as a project for the future, of appealing to Muslim scriptures for scrutinizing contemporary political and social questions, and scientific questions as well. This is the second matter that arises from the consideration of modernity. There is, in short, a certain presumption of Muslim exceptionalism. There is more to this claim for exceptionalism than echoes of Muslim voices, as they are called, powerful as these echoes may clearly have become. There is, crucially, the politics of identity, which has replaced the politics of development and of progress, the divisions of left and right that had had their day prior to the end of the Cold War. This is so not only among Muslims. From the cult of memory to the memory industry so salient to historical and quasi-historical writings in the last two decades, to matters associated with it, such as the cult of historical apology, political correctness, restrictive codes of speech, ease with taking offense. From the late Professor Huntington's pastiche of Spengler, snugly fitting into the rhetoric of the War on Terror and his strictures against the de-waspification of the United States, onto discussions of the European Constitution in terms of the continent's pre-Enlightenment religious heritage, anxiety about immigration, about Turkish membership in the European community. It's all a package. And I'm not mentioning the Hindu inflection of Indian nationalism and analogous phenomena worldwide. Ultimately, both the advocates and the adversaries of identitarian difference are objectively complicit. They share the assumption of irreducible, incommensurable, and fated ethno-historical difference, the one in the mode of celebration, the other of anxiety and indeed of war. Both represent the current culturalist version of what in the first half of the 20th century was thought to be the ineradicable distinction between races. In such circumstances, exceptionalism becomes an almost compulsive meta-historical postulate and a criterion of cultural, ethnological, and socio-political classification. It takes on the nature of a commonplace. Like all commonplaces which stand for self-evidence, it becomes to question in any consequential manner. Muslim life, seen as captive to summary medieval political traditions is part of this global package. It is ultimately an advocacy of fractious communalism, which invariably looks at the imagined past as the alternative to an open future. While such is often regarded as a solution to current crises, it is rather a symptom of crisis and not a solution to it. I had referred early on in my lecture to a certain incuriosity. And it is to this matter that such incuriosity refers. Thank you very much.
Mohamed Hadidi from ADCO. One theme that I understood from your talk was that the modern Muslim Salafism was influenced by Protestantism. Is it possible to consider the causal relationship in the opposite direction? That is, that Protestantism was influenced by Muslim iconoclasm and so on?
Thank you. A number of things might be said. The question of iconoclasm, of course, Muslim iconoclasm came in fairly early on in the during the Umayyad period, and not earlier. It was not extremely early. More or less at the same time as Byzantine iconoclasm. And as you may well imagine, there is a very long tradition of iconoclasm, both Jewish and Christian, deriving from the Old Testament. So iconoclasm really is quite a constituent element, always marginal, but always there. When I spoke of the relationship between Protestantism and Muslim reform, I was referring actually to the generation of Muhammad Abdo and Al-Afghani, who made this connection very explicitly. In fact, Al-Afghani thought that he himself might be the Muslim Luther, and Muhammad Abdo would be the theologian. That is to say, Luther had a theologian by the name of Melanchthon, that Muhammad Abdo might be Melanchthon and he might be Luther. He would give the political force, the political energy, and someone else would do the elaboration, the theoretical elaboration for him, which did work for a short period of time, the time of Al-Urwa al-Wuthqa, the publication in Paris in the 1870s, 1880s, I'm not sure of the date. Now, these are two elements. One other element, then there is, of course, the theoretical element. The appeal to the scripture only is actually only possible under modern conditions. It is not thinkable before the age of printing and before the age of the availability of scriptures widely. Prior to that, scriptures, both for Muslims and for Christians, were generally read in extracts for specific purposes. Not very many people actually owned full copies of the Gospels or of the Quran until the age of printing. So that appeal cannot actually then become practicable unless these basic material conditions exist. Finally, one last comment. There is no doubt that certain expressions of Christian religiosity in the last 10 years specifically, most importantly the Catholic, I think are done are energized by the impact of the very great public exposure of Muslim piety elsewhere, including acts of violence, which to the Pope, for example, betokens. Of course, he does not condone violence. Very few people do condone violence, but it actually betokens a fervent faith, an ardent faith, which he bemoans, the lack of which he bemoans among his own people. So I think there is now a correlation, namely that public expressions of Muslim piety are becoming in themselves, are being relayed, as it were, in the wider mobilization of expressions, public expressions of Christian piety. So the answer is multifaceted, the question is complex, and the answer must take account.
The Umayyad caliphs and earlier Abbasi fulfilled the Constantine dreams, or maybe the Abbasi, they have al-Hikmah house and translate the Greeks books, but Umayyad, they did not have these things.
Yes.
How they know the Constantine theology?
Yeah. Let me tell you, just to put the question of Constantine's dream in context, of course, in a lecture one can't explain every detail. So let me just say a couple of words to this. Constantine's dream designates the idea of Constantine that he might, under his authority, unite all the civilized world of the time, comprising Europe and Western Asia and North Africa. Now, the history of the Byzantine Empire thereafter was somewhat, and to unite them in a very specific way, that is to say, he would build an empire which is at once an exercise of central political and military power, and secondly, an empire which is fired and which takes as its purpose a particular religious mission, which it might wish to spread universally. This is what is designated by Constantine's dream. And there is actually a textual reference. There is a book by a colleague and friend of mine on the polities of late antiquity. His name is Garth Foden. He is a classical historian who's written very important works also on the Umayyads. And it is he actually who makes this who makes this connection, and I'm now acknowledging the quotation.
Jamil Muhammad, ECAE. Historically, Islam was implemented comprehensively, which basically meant that it regulated the behavior between the individual and Allah. It regulated the individual and himself, clothing and so forth, food, type of food they eat. Thirdly, it regulated the relationship between individuals within the society. When we look at in the museums across the Muslim world, we see that their only reference point to solve these problems was Islam. So the question really is Islam suitable to solve the problems of every age and time? And
is Islam suitable? Is that the word you used?
Yeah. Is Islam suitable to solve the problems of every age and time and remain consistent with its own unique basis without deviation, which if it does, we would say it is modern. But I wouldn't say it agrees with modernity, because modernity in one sense means that you believe in the viewpoint and basis of secular liberalism. If we look at how Islam views men and women, they view them as human beings with certain needs and instinct, which does not change with time and place. And it deals with them. If someone lives in the past, they might have lived in a hut. Now they live in skyscrapers, sending messages by horseback, now by email. Instincts remain there, the reverence instinct, the survival instinct, these all need satisfying. Needing food is there. Through ijtihad and the proper application of ijtihad, using the Sharia text only, Islam is capable. But the issue here is that Islam is not implemented comprehensively. Thank you.
Right. Now, you are claiming that Islam was implemented comprehensively. Now, this in itself, to me, is a vexatious statement. First of all, it's not a question of implementation. When you speak of comprehensive implementation, you are actually assuming that there is something which is prepared ahead of time and then programmed into a kind of into a social process. Islam, like all other religions, developed over time. Nothing escapes development over time. It developed over time. It developed in different forms. It related very variously to social practices. Don't forget, you're talking about 1,500 years over a vast territorial expanse. It would not be within the limits of the probable, first of all, that any pre-programmed image of social organization might have been effectively enforced over such an expanse and over such time. And it is unthinkable that Islam is simply a self-contained, rather a self-contained package, which is a kind of checklist, which where then we can check against social realities. This is not the way reality works. What you are presenting, what you are representing to us, is a particular ideological reading of Quran, of Islam, which is not an historical reading. Now, ideological readings can take various forms. One may think of Islam, provided one knows how to define it. What is it that one takes and what is it that one leaves? If you're taking, for instance, let us take, just to unpack your question a little bit. If we were to take classical Muslim law, you will find in classical Muslim law, for virtually every topic, with the exception, with the partial exception, not a total exception, of devotions, that is to say prayer and fasting and pilgrimage, you will find quite a variety of rulings which relate to their points of origin, because it is a body of law, like all human laws, it developed over time. And as I suggested in the lecture, the relationship, the religious aspect of law is in fact not reflected in the genesis of law. It is a later retrospective ideologization of this law. You speak of ijtihad, yes, one can speak of ijtihad, but then ijtihad within what limits and according to what kinds of principles? If you were to read the fatwas of Muhammad Abdu or of the early Rashid Rida, you will find a tremendous degree of innovation and of the accommodation of changing circumstances. Now, the trouble with this is that they are not intellectually satisfying. They tend to be rather rhetorical. There's a lot of the squaring of circles. For instance, Muhammad Abdu said that one can actually read Darwin's theory of evolution in the body of the Quran. There are claims of this kind made all the time. Shura and democracy, scientific interpretation of the Quran, and so on and so forth. There's a tremendous output on these things. But it actually then, it needs to impute to the Quranic texts things that cannot be contained in it. And then it makes a kind of equivalent between Quranic statements and things that occur later. There have been other theologies, particularly amongst the Christians, who have tried to overcome this dilemma, sometimes very creatively. Most specifically, they have tended really to spiritualize and to symbolize matters that occur in the New Testament. For instance, the idea of virgin birth or the idea of walking on water and so on and so forth, which are in the highest degree improbable. So the matter cannot be stated summarily, you see. You cannot state summarily that this is a religion which is relevant for all times and places, full stop. We have to know precisely what we're talking about, precisely under what circumstances, and in every possible case. We cannot make a summary or a blanket statement upon this.
My name is Delfina Serrano. I work for the High Council for Scientific Research in Madrid, Spain. You mentioned that before modernity, no Islamic regime tried to re-actualize the model of Medina. And I agree with you. However, I would like to know your view or to know how you characterize reform movements such as those of the Almoravids and the Almohads in the Islamic West. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much. Yes, the idea of reactualization, of course, was in fact meaningless. And indeed, apropos what my friend over there said, the idea of something which is completely closed and completely set in stone would have been incomprehensible to a classical Muslim faqih or a divine. It would have been incomprehensible. The Almoravids and the Almohads, well, I mean, there are many things to say about both. They represent theological, I mean, because these were, as you know, very, very complex movements. There were complex conditions of emergence. They founded large-scale states of varying length, of varying duration. It's actually very difficult to answer a question which is stated in this form. How would you comment on the Almohads and the Almoravids? But let me try. Ibn Tumart himself of the Almohads, for instance, was a rather an exacting, very traditional Ash'arite theologian. Possibly had studied under Al-Ghazali, but I think this is probably apocryphal. Who had little by way of theological imagination or intellectual imagination. He was very much an imitator, and he was a summarizer of doctrines which came from elsewhere. Both, but most particularly the Almoravids, actually used personal behavior, the regulation of personal behavior, and not for a very long period of time. Let's not forget that they were also the patrons of Ibn Rushd, of Averroes, and then sacrificed him for political reasons, which happen very frequently. So they used these patterns of self-regulation for a very specific purpose. Because they were trying to sedentarize a military caste, which they were, coming from the Sahara. They were trying to sedentarize, and they were trying actually to exert a very strong instance of social control in a situation of very rapid change. This is how I would see them.
We'd like to thank New York University very much for these events, actually, and these debates. They are very very constructive. We never have such opportunity before. I would like to thank Professor Philip Kennedy, exactly the way he introduced you, Professor Al-Azizi. And I would like you, as he described you, you always have the courage, actually, to speak on different controversial issues. Can you please describe to us how the Arab Muslims lived and dominate Spain and part of Europe between 712 and about 1500 or 1492. How was the religious toleration? How was the scientific movement? How was the university or education and intellectual environment? And please, since you talk about actually and you compared between the Islamic political traditions and between the Protestants in the United States, including the evangelists, how do you describe the new conservative or the new Zionist Christians, which I think George Bush was one of them, and how actually you explain that your lecture, could it be in this particular concept if there were no 11th of September 2001? And how do you really compare or connect the modern Muslim political tradition, you are a professor of history, with the new conservatives and Christian Zionists in the United States. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You know, I really don't know where to start. I mean, you asked me so many questions. I will pick and choose. First of all, as regards Spain, I will defer to this lady from the Consejo Nacional, and she will, I'm sure, be able to tell you all about it. Yes, I mean, clearly it was there was a lot of flourishing, and there have been very many studies of the relationship between of this, as usually called, the, this grand synthesis. Of course, occasionally we get a much too rosy picture. It's not that I don't like to see rosy pictures, but I fail to see any rosy period in history, full stop. But of course, yes, there was a tremendous amount of prosperity. There was flourishing literature. Much of it, incidentally, I must say, derivative of the Baghdad models, but the situation within Al-Andalus was quite flourishing. And as you know, there were Jews who were chief ministers of a variety of the sultans, particularly in the age of the Taifas. So this is a very, very interesting story. And we Arabs, of course, including myself, have a very romantic view of the Andalus. And I really, I would like someone to do a study, a proper thesis on the romance of the Andalus in modern Arab life and literature and music and so on and so forth. As for the evangelists, neocons, and so forth, first of all, my talk, of course, would have been perfectly conceivable before 9/11. I've said things along the same lines for a long time before. 9/11 actually has made matters much more acute, has made modes of expression far more acute. And the American neocons are really of two varieties, very broadly speaking, since we can't go into detail. There are the godless ones, that is to say, the secular ones, Wolfensohn, quite a number of others, and their mentors. And of course, there are, that is to say, the secular ones whose neoconservatism was primarily a form of neo-imperialism and realpolitik and so forth. And there is the other variety of neocons which has a religious attitude. Now, there are Zionist Christians. And incidentally, interestingly, Protestantism, in varying degrees at various times and places, has had a particular interest in the Old Testament, unlike the Catholics and unlike the Orthodox, right? And when there was a radical Protestant regime put up in Münster in the early 17th century, it was actually run along Mosaic lines, including polygamy and quite a number of practices which they extracted from the Old Testament. There are two kinds of Zionist Christians. There are those who make the question of Jewish presence in Palestine as the most crucial matter, because as you know, the ingathering of Jews in Palestine would, for those Protestants, then make possible the end of days, right? It will make possible the end of days, so they are enhancing the end of days. There is that other variety which has not so much a doctrinal or an eschatological view of this as a much more decidedly and politically pro-Israeli view. So really, there is a whole range of possible positions there regarding the relationship between Protestantism and Zionism. Protestant Zionism is Zionism designed to bring all the Jews to Israel, who will ultimately convert to Christianity and then precipitate the end of days. That is the eschatological view.
My name is Zeki Ajawi. I'm an architect. Just to follow up on the gentleman's comment about Islam being a universal and timeless religion, actually a lot of the teachings of Islam are being practiced in Japan and the United States as at the time that in in Muslim countries, a lot of scholars are giving fatwas on, I mean, adapting to the modern world and going away from the essence of the Islamic teaching itself. I mean, to what point are, I mean, to what extent are scholars going to continue adapting to the modern world and the globalization to the point, I mean, and lose the essence of the real Islam? So how can that
be? You know,
be?
I mean, the question of the real Islam will generate quite a variety of answers depending on who you ask what is real and what is not, right? Presuming that there is one essence does not actually make sense and will not bring consensus, because there are different people with different interpretations. This has always been the case. This is not only new. So I can't answer a question whose assumptions I don't think are sensible, all right? With regard to the question of fatwas, of course, there's a whole range. There are fatwas which are extremely archaizing. You should not shake hands with Christians. You should not accept hospitality from them. And quite a number of such positions. And there are others who try to, not so much to legitimate the imperatives of modern life in terms of reference to the scriptures, to Muslim scriptures, as much as to claim, like the reformists, that they are in a certain way equivalent. Now, unfortunately, and I mentioned this in the course of my lecture, we see very decidedly a tendency, even for reformists, to harden positions and to become more and more conservative, because they are actually besieged by more rigorous and politically more active forces. So they're actually protecting their flanks.
Thank you. Yeah, my name is Abbad Al-Radi. I'd like to ask you a question about the context in which you see your lecture placed. And when you talk about the relevance or irrelevance of Muslim political traditions, in what form of polity do you see this? I mean, is this the modern Western democratic society in which church and state have been separated for some time, or what?
Well, I mean, I think I made it quite clear that I thought, first of all, that Muslim political traditions were extremely complex, and secondly, that they have largely disappeared, and that calls for their reinstatement are contrived and out of keeping with the realities of social life and with what's that happened to us in the past 100 years. So I did not, in fact, at any point advocate a particular model or speak of a particular model. I'm simply trying to put things in historical perspective. And that was the whole purpose of my lecture. I hope there was no misunderstanding.
My name is Ghassan Shaar from EDNIC. George W. Bush and Tony Blair, Putin in 2007, clearly stated that about the threat of the return of the Khilafah that would unite the Muslim world from Indonesia to Morocco, implement Sharia. Now, Sharia that they are referring to, and they also made this clear, they said the Muslims want to take us back 1300 years ago. So should we take your word that Islam has been developed and the Sharia has been developed, or should we take their word that the same Islam we are calling today is the same Islam 1300 years ago? That's point one. Point two, don't you think it's unfair, really, to compare Islam with Christianity simply because in Christianity, for example, what is the economic system in the Bible? Is it a mixed economy? What is that in the Bible? What is the ruling system? Is it democracy? Doesn't democracy mean separating life from religion? Whereas in Islam, as you know, we have the ruling system in Islam, social system in Islam, economic system in Islam. Maybe there are some interpretations, as you may said, but as always, the reference point is back to Quran and Sunnah. Thank you.
Thank you. This is a very good question, actually. With respect to Khilafah, I mean, I would treat it in exactly the same way as I treat charges of Iraq having weapons of mass destruction. All right? So, yeah. So I mean, this is as what we say in Arabic. I don't know if there is an equivalent like a barbar. It is a barbar, as it's called in Arabic. Kind of a scarecrow.
Straw hat.
Or straw. Yeah. Anyway, no, but it's more uncanny. Anyway, they used to scare small children with the barbar, and if they didn't behave well. With regard to the question of the social model or the economic model, of course, all you need to do if you're talking about something called an Islamic economy. First of all, let's look at Islamic banking and Islamic investment. There are a number of legal forms which they take, and which they had taken for a very long time. The Latin name for this, the Latin blanket name, is the commenda. And it was actually the commercial law, not only of Muslim lands, but also of Europe in the Middle Ages. It is a particular form of association. It has a clearly discernible shape. And it is actually marketed as such by Islamic banks and Islamic financial organizations. However, the interesting thing is that much of the deposits, if you'd read the excellent book of Ibrahim Werdi, published originally in, I think, either French or English, I can't remember, on Islamic banking, you would find that ultimately the deposits actually find their way into the international network of investments and actually do obey the laws of the market as they do exist. The second thing one might look at is, Iran is an Islamic state. Iran is an Islamic state. Don't shake your head. It is an Islam. I mean, I would call an Islamic state any state which calls itself Islamic, because I don't think there is something, there is an essence to it. There are many different forms. The debates on economic policy within Iran have the full range of those who advocate a Friedmanian kind of free market system, and those who go to a kind of statism, ultimately to a form of state socialism as well. You have the whole range of possible economic forms presented in a religious language. Now, the crucial thing is not the language. The crucial thing is actually the kinds of economic forms. And these are the only possible forms of economic organization which are possible, which have been possible in the 20th and 21st centuries. You cannot actually have an economic system which is operative in the year 2010, which might have been useful, or which might have been operative or even dominant in 1,000 years earlier, not least because of the social contexts of economic policies. Societies have changed tremendously, and therefore also economies have changed. Now, with respect to the commenda, what actually makes it practicable is that it does have a fairly clear contractual and technically legal form. So it is actually practicable in this particular sense. However, it has to operate, and it does operate, within a broader context of economic relations as they exist today.
My question was a two-part question, which has become only a one-part question based on all the back and forth that has happened. If we were to concede that there's a lot of Muslim political traditions that do not actually find themselves in the root of Islam, but were developed during certain periods and have become now, somebody has decided to ideologize them. So my question is, you said that printing was a specific moment that allowed for a lot of, the sharing of scripture. Do you feel that with the emergence of the internet, with social media, with a lot of more people being able to have exposure to ideas and sharing, do you think that this could help propel the reformist version of Islam that does accept, as you say, that Islam will, through ijtihad and through different things, will deal with different periods of Islam. And so that this could be the vessel of which to start debating and rejecting certain traditions that have been dragged onto us 200 years ago, 300 years ago. And this could be what printing was when it came out to the Protestant movement or even to other movements.
Thank you very much. Yes, I mean, something happened also among Muslims with regard to printing, particularly when, the first actually widely distributed and printed version, the first print version of the Quran dates to 1926. 1926. Prior to that, the only printed versions were printed in the 16th century in Venice, and the Gustav Flügel edition in the middle of the 19th century. But the first one that was widely available is the edition of Cairo, more or less at the same time as another edition with another reading, with another of the Quranic, it's the Hafs an Asim version, which is the Cairo one, and the other one was Moroccan. Prior to that, people read ajza', various parts, or they had manuscripts, or they had access to manuscripts. Now, with regard to the internet actually is a very interesting medium because, yes, the kind of Islam that you are advocating, or that you might advocate, or that others might advocate, let's take it whichever way it comes, is of course accessible. However, the fear is that there is a predominance of far more rigorous and conservative websites with much wider readership on the internet. So yes, I mean, the internet can perform this, but given the present condition of increasing conservatism, it is rather the other side which is gaining the upper hand. I suppose this must also be it, yes. And this might also be it. And of course, let us not forget the imbrication of once reformist Islam as the official Islam of the state. I'm speaking specifically of countries like Tunisia, Syria, Egypt, Iraq. Yeah.
My name is Abdullah Al-Kaabi. I'm a BA student in UAEU. I have a question. Actually, in the beginning of Islam, Muslims, basically early Muslims, had basically nothing. There wasn't any education system, there wasn't any economic system. And as the era of the Prophet Muhammad السلام, went on, the Islamic regime, the economic system and the politics of the Islamic country developed, especially in the era of Umar ibn al-Khattab. And as it goes, it develops the architecture, the economics, the everything. And they started with basically nothing. So it's a shame when you read in a scientific paper that they copied from the early civilization that they learned from. And it's also not right to read in other papers that the economic system of the West copies from Islam a few things, yeah, from the religion and from the economic system. So really, about Islam and how it began and how it developed, Doctor, what do you think?
Yes, this is a legitimate question. Let me tell you two things. First of all, I didn't say that they copied. What I said was that after the conquests, the Arabs, and we're talking now of the Umayyads in the beginning, found themselves in very highly economically and culturally elaborated territories where they installed themselves and absorbed the culture of the place, which is natural. Exchange in history is natural. It's almost invariably denied, but it is natural. Now, look at the question. I'll give you another question which might please you a little bit more. The question of the transference of Arab natural sciences to medieval Europe. Of course, they absorbed it. They took mathematics, they took astronomy, they took pharmacology, medicine. In fact, Avicenna's Canon of Medicine was still a textbook in European universities until the early 18th century. Bear that in mind. That's quite a long time, 800 years as a textbook. However, the important thing there is to see, is to realize that they took all these things and then they developed them into a new form, into a much more elaborated form of science during the 17th, 18th, 19th centuries. To the extent that the origins actually then are no longer salient. In the same way, the Umayyads took state institutions, bureaucratic institutions, various forms of architecture, quite a lot. Took them up quite naturally, lived through them, elaborated them, and then renamed them, and in time these developed as well. And this is hadi sunnat al-hayat, sunnat al-tariq.
Well, thank you for all your questions, right? Thank you. Let me just, I feel obligated to say one of the among the many features or characteristics of Ibn Khaldun in describing him as an alim, a polymath, apart from the fact that he was an economist, a sociologist, a philosopher, a theologian, a faqih, a historian, was that he was a hafiz, a man who memorized the Quran. I mean, with great intellect, he had a great memory, and I think you are a hafiz with great intellect and a great memory.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.